Well, search me, Lord.
Search me, Lord.
Please search me, Lord.
Search me, Lord.
And I'll turn
the lights from heaven on in my soul. And if you find anything that shouldn't be,
well,
take it out and strengthen me. I want to live right. Want to be saved. Want to be whole.
About the winds of the world. The winds of the world, you know, blowing all the time. You have to stay strong in the Lord to avoid the winds of the world. Listen.
Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side.
Children.
are hearing, for heaven's sake, for the very first time. We've already sung two songs. I mean, this is your first time that you've been, okay, good. I'll tell you who we are then real quick. Down on the one that you just heard sing that song right there, she's the newest member of this group. She's a rookie. She's
happens to be the youngest.
Yeah, she's youngest. She works at WVHM or the Heartland radio station over there. You probably heard her on radio before. We're so proud to have her. Her name is Leanne Paris. Y'all make her welcome. The lowdown guy over there. I mean, I'm the one that sings the lowdown part. Yeah.
I know what you mean.
He's been with us now for going on what?
7 years.
Going on 7 years. He was in Texas singing with a pro group. Then he come up here and got with a good group. And, for heaven's sake, and been with us now for going on 7 years, Brother Jess Farmer. Y'all make him. This one right here is when we started this group, which is sometime like almost 19 years ago that we started this group. She let me know real quick that she was going to be the boss. And here it is 19 years later, she's still the boss. This is my wife, LaWanda Glover. Would y'all make her welcome? We're glad to have Miss Nancy there. That's Jess's better half right there. And my only ally, believe me. She's the only one that takes up for me no matter what. Against these three. Nancy Farmer. Make her welcome.
Oh, we've got a good friend of mine here. He goes to our church. We go to Calvary Temple Church in Murray. And this is Brother Tim Pace right here on the front row. Or third row, actually, right there. And he called the other day and asked if he could ride over with us. And I said, well, I don't know. I'm going to have to ask and see. We're really don't like. Well, so as far as I'll take it right there.
Well, I asked you, I said, can he pack equipment pretty good? And he said, yeah, so bring him on. Well, my name's Mike Glover, yeah, and I make up the. I'm the reason that they probably hand out applications after it's over. Y'all like. No, wait a minute, let me ask a question. Just, would you mind looking back there? How many of y'all like bass singing? Y'all like?
Yes. Absolutely.
One, two, Nancy and your guy at your church song. So, but would you sing a song? Can you?
It don't matter, I'm going to sing anyway.
Yeah.
Going in style someday when this life is through. I'll be sailing past the Milky Way, all the stars and planets too. I'll be traveling in love to regain closer every mile. To a mansion waiting just for me, I'll be going in style. I've never been much of a world-class traveler, for my hard-earned pay. But Jesus has promised me a first-class ticket on a flight someday. The time of departure isn't set, could be just a little while. I'll be headed for heaven when I start my journey. I'll be going in style. I'll be going in style someday when this life is through.
When this life is through.
I'll be sailing past the Milky Way, all the stars and planets. I'll be traveling in love to regain closer every mile. To the mansion waiting just for me. I'll be going in style.
I'll be going in style someday.
don't get him started, please. I like that song, don't y'all?
Amen.
I've always wanted to go in style. When the Lord can, I hope he lets me go out like Elijah did in that fiery chariot. That's the way I want to go. This song right here talks about this song is good to know this time of the world that we're living in. I don't know whether y'all believe this or not. How many of y'all worry?
Try not to.
You know, it's a sin. I think it's a sin to worry, to be honest with you. It's not showing much faith. But it's hard not to worry in this. Now, I'm trying my best not to worry, be concerned. I'm very concerned about a lot of things I see going on in the world today. But I'm not going to worry because I got a Lord. I know what the end of the chapter looks like, sounds like.
Right.
We know what the end of the story is, and that's what I'm going to just hold on to. I'm going to hang my hat on that God's got everything under control, and this song is kind of a 50s style little song here. I love this, but it talks about nothing's going to worry me. Listen.
Cause in control, and he's got us.
Y'all notice that when I was up here, I had to set this down. This is what I can control the music with this. And wasn't too long ago, about 2.5 years ago, I had a stroke. So I don't have much right hand at all. So I have to hold everything with the left hand. We was at a concert one time, and we were singing one of them get up songs. Boy, I'd get with it like this. I changed the music 5 times. I thought, what's going on? What are y'all singing? You know, and it was me all the time. I was changing. So, speaking of which, you know, back when I had that stroke, I thought, oh, man, I'm done for. I thought I was a goner. I really did. I had a stroke, and it completely paralyzed my right side, the whole right side. I was in the hospital for 16 days, and I couldn't even do anything. If I leaned to the right, I just fell to the right. Couldn't catch myself at all. But through prayer of everybody praying for me, I got better. That's the reason I'm still here today. I couldn't sing a lick, and don't say anything. They say, well, you still struggle. But anyway, I had so many people praying for me, and I could feel the prayers. I'm telling you right now, I could feel them. It was like especially during church time, you know, it was almost like a warm blanket just pulled right up over me when people were praying for me. And that's why I know that there's power in prayer.
There is power.
up and say that anywhere, anytime. So if you got any, you preachers got any churches that doubt you on that, call me. I'll tell them. I don't mind telling them. All right, here. Now, I'm going to holler at you just a minute in this song. Won't y'all help me out? Sound okay?
That's right.
Amen. Is it? I mean, we just got these little telephone poles over here.
Why are you worried about being rude now, boy? You're being rude all night long.
We're visiting. Is the sound okay? Is the sound all right back there?
That's
great.
Okay.
Okay.
Now
we're
good.
All right, Mr. Rude, go ahead.
And you just might find the light of the road that you bear. You know, with all the sorrow and trouble in this world, it seems like the least we can do is make a spot into the street, sharing every mighty
every day, every day, every day.
Okay. Well, y'all can sit back down now. You know, we're very reluctant in asking people to stand up because usually they leave.
We hadn't ate yet.
That's right. That's a good thing about singing before the food.
I'll even shake your hand. How are you, brother?
I love this song right here. I hope y'all enjoy it. This is one of my favorites that Leanne does. That's also the power of having this thing right here.
I thought I was the boss.
You are.
We'll kick you.
Yeah, y'all don't care for us practicing on y'all, do you? I don't know where it's at, but I'll find it. Oh, I found it. This is really an old song, but we're just now learning it, so if you hear somebody saying watermelon, watermelon, this is probably me. So here we go.
Walking right, gave me eyes to see the light of the day.
This is the day that the Lord hath made.
This is the day,
this is the day that the Lord hath made.
That the Lord hath made.
I will rejoice.
And he danced practically naked all the way down the street. I'm not going to do that.
He had rhythm.
Stand up just a minute, brother.
I'm going to try to stand over there. Interesting.
You want to bring that up?
No. I think people can see me over. I can get back there.
No.
I don't need to bring
that
up.
We didn't use that one that we
got. How about this one?
Okay.
It's small.
That's hard to go. I got it. I got one hand. What do you know?
Didn't nobody tell you this time?
I'll help the man bring it up.
I like that. He is eager. He is ready. I don't believe I could stand in his way.
Not many people can.
Are you having a good time tonight?
Amen.
Amen. Let's give for heaven's sake a hand.
Amen.
Billy Joe Fuller and I, and I'll tell you, I had to ask him privately if there was something I missed somewhere along the way through the years. Our families go back almost to childhood. I can't even actually remember when we were introduced. I was probably a teenager, and he was probably about 8 or 9. Time passes. We hadn't seen each other. About 3 years ago, we got invited to Jackson's Chapel's service in the park. I'm standing there talking to somebody. I don't know if it's you. Might have been you, Brother Bobby. I don't know. Minding my own business for once. Brother Bobby kind of knows me. I feel this thump on my back. It wasn't no tap, it was a thump. And I turned around. It looked like this big biker guy standing there right in front of me. And he said, "Do you remember me?" And I did, kind of by the face, except he got old and he had this biker look going on. And then his wife came around him and I thought, he said, "You performed our wedding 30 years ago."
Wow.
That was kind of cool. Just fresh into the ministry, just starting out. And I'm glad that he's here. I'm excited. I've heard him. Some of our folks have heard him at the park, and he did an outstanding job.
Yep.
But before he comes tonight, his pastor is here. That ought to put fear in his heart. Brother Bobby and I went to college together. And
nobody's ever going to believe that either one of us went to college. But you go ahead.
That's true, actually. I was only going to suggest, and most of these people can't get this joke, but don't treat him like Tom Atwood did us.
Oh, yeah.
Y'all know what homiletics is? That's where they teach you how to preach. It didn't work. Probably because we had a professor that was looked like he'd been weaned on dill pickles. And the nothing you could muster, Jesus could have came in and preached under the power of his own spirit, and Tom Atwood found fault with it. So don't do him that way. Billy Joe Fuller, let's pray together. Brother Bobby, you pray over him, and then we're going to let him preach. Brother Billy, just act like there's no food in the fellowship hall.
All right. Father, thank you so much for loving us. Lord, for me, one of the expressions of your love is the people that you send into my life. I get to watch you work in their lives. It reminds me of how
how loving and how powerful you are. Lord, I know that Billy's faithful to you. He's faithful to his family and he's faithful to his church. God, I pray your blessing tonight that he can be hidden behind the cross of Jesus Christ, that we might hear you speak through him in Jesus' name.
Yeah. Brother Billy, you come.
Thank y'all for having me tonight. Like Gene said, my name is Joe Fuller. Born and raised right here in Crutchfield, not too far from this place. If you knew my family, the Fullers, we own the beer store, actually. So that's the background I come from. It is. I'm very humbled to be here tonight. I have a lot of friends and support here. Like I say, I've known Gene almost all my life. And there's another man here I've known for over 20 years, and he knew me during some of the very darkest years of my life. Actually, we were both in the dark at that time. And seeing him sit out here encouraging me and praying for me just humbled me to no end. And here we are tonight, taking out an old year and bringing in a new. And I've been doing this about a year now. I surrendered a year ago, and my church has allowed me to practice and work on this to get better at it. And I'm thankful for that, and I hope that I can get across tonight what I feel like the Lord has showed me. I had prayed for a large gathering, but here's the thing. I know that the people that are here, the ones that need to hear this, whether for themselves or for somebody else. Yeah. So if you have your Bibles tonight, I'm actually going to be reading from two different places. It's a single idea. It's a single thing, but it's carried out from one place and then brought about in another. So if you want to start in Exodus 12, you've got your Bibles tonight. We're going to start with the first verse of chapter 12 in Exodus 12. I'll give everybody a moment to get there. I keep turning pages. Again, I'm very humbled to be here tonight. I don't know. Because like I say, I don't live about 7 miles down the road from here. And to think that, you know, all this has happened in my hometown where I grew up, where people knew me and have watched me grow up. I'm guaranteeing you right now, most of them would have never envisioned this for me. They never would have. So, okay, I don't see anybody else turning the pages, so I'm going to start to read Exodus 12, 1 and 2. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you." Now, go ahead and move over to Deuteronomy 16, where we finished that statement, basically. I think everybody's there. Chapter 16, verse 1, "Observe the month of Abib." That was the month that he was talking about back in Exodus, the first month. "Observe the month of Abib and keep the Passover of the Lord your God in the month of Abib. The Lord your God brought you out of the land of Egypt by night. Therefore you shall sacrifice the Passover of the Lord, or to the Lord your God, from the flock and from the herds, and in the place where the Lord chooses to put his name. You shall eat the unleavened bread with it. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread with it, that is, the bread of affliction. For you came out of the land of Egypt in haste, that you may remember the day in which you came out of the land of Egypt, all the days of your life." Now, like I said, we're bringing out an old year, bringing in a new year. And I think it's important at this time of the year that we all take a moment to remember. To remember. And it's important to remember. It truly is. You know, we live in a society today where everybody wants you to forget. Just forget about your past. Don't drag that along with you. Don't live back there. Focus on the forward. But the Bible shows us that it's good to take a moment and look backwards. To look backwards. And why did God establish this for the people of Israel?
because he wanted them to remember the day that he set them free, that he brought them out of Egypt. Okay? That's what he wants them to remember. And today, as we look around us, I think that's what God's wanting us to do now. All year long, I told you a while ago, I surrendered about a year ago, and I've had the opportunity to speak many times, thanks to Bobby, my pastor. And I've said this many times at my home church, all year long, in every message that I have prepared, there's been one word that is screamed in my head. I can't get rid of it. Whether I'm up here, or teaching a Sunday school class, or just at work, I keep hearing God say over and over and over again, remember. Remember. So what is he wanting us to remember? What on tonight, as we're bringing in a new year, does he want us to remember? And while I know the people that I've got here are faithful, or they wouldn't be here, I can see that. And I'm probably preaching to the choir, but like I said, if it's not for you, I know it's for somebody you know. Okay? So what does God want us to remember? I think the first thing he wants us to remember is who he is. Who is our God? Do you think about it often anymore? Do you think about it like you did when you first got saved? I know when I did, man, all I could think about was who my God was.
Amen.
What he had done and all the things that I had heard. We need to remember our God and who he is. He is a holy God. Think about it. You know, in Revelations 4:8, we hear about the angels. The four creatures, the beasts that fly over the throne of God every day, day in, day out, nonstop. And what do they say? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
That's right.
Why do you think they sit there and repeat that all the time? Because they want everybody to remember our God is holy. Our God is holy. And our God is our creator. Our God has power. You know, I'm an engineer. I'm a technician. And when I think of power, I think of electricity. Well, if you've ever grown up on a farm and had what we used to call a weed burner, that was some really powerful electric fence. And you could stand by it, and you could hear the electricity travel through the line. Just, And when I think about God, that's what I think. He is so mighty. I mean, you think about the stories that we read about in the Bible, like John. You know, when he first came into the presence, he couldn't stand. The very power of God overwhelmed him. He was given something to allow him to stand. Okay? God is powerful. He is powerful, and we need to remember that. And we need to remember that nothing consists without him, that he's holding everything together. That while we live in a society today where people think things are uncertain. They're worried about the climate, and if we don't do something about it, the planet's going to be destroyed. They're worried about whether that they're getting paid as much as somebody else. They're worried about everything. It's all going to fall apart if we don't do something. Somebody's not going to get what they deserve if we don't do something. But my Bible tells me that my God holds it all together.
All right.
Holds it all together.
That's right.
So God wants us to remember who he was, but that's not the only thing I think he wants us to remember. I think he wants to remember who we are.
Yeah.
Who are we? I'm not the same anymore. I'm not just Billy Joe Fuller anymore. I'm a child of the Most High God.
Amen.
And I think everybody in this building tonight is a child of the Most High God. We need to remember that. Because if we are children of the Most High God, what can we expect from our God? We can expect him to sustain us. We can expect him to take care of us. We can expect him to see us through anything. And that's where remembering comes into play. How do we deal with these things when life comes at us? You know, I listened to you, Brother Glover, talk about your stroke and how the people prayed for you. So you had to look back to tell that story. And what did that hold? That held hope. It holds a truth that you can trust your God to take care of you. You were sick. You couldn't perform your service to the Lord anymore, and I'm sure that broke your heart. Here you are tonight as a living testimony of what God will do.
Amen. Come on.
All right? You are, brother. And you encouraged me, and as you gave that, they gave me a little courage to get up here and do this tonight, and I thank you for it. I really do. God's calling his people to remember. God's calling his church to remember, and I think the reason why he's doing it is because we're asleep.
Yeah.
And I think it's time that we wake up.
Amen.
I believe that the time is drawing shorter and shorter every day. I know I grew up with parents and grandparents that say they believed that God could come at any time. But if you looked at the Bible, there was still a lot that had to be fulfilled. A lot. Well, folks, you look at the Bible today, here just a, and that's the amazing thing about it. That's why I think the Lord has been screaming to remember, is our time is running out. I believe that. You look at the rate and the pace at which things are changing.
Yep.
It should get your attention. Things stayed the same for 100 years. You hardly saw any changes in society, in culture, in anything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in just my lifetime of 55 years, we've gone from a society that knew, and I hope I don't offend anybody, that knew what a man and woman was.
That's right. Come on.
Amen.
But now, in today's society, that's a debate. We got to remember. We got to remember God made us male and female. God made us man and woman for a reason. And we need to remember that. And we need to remind people of that. And we need to encourage people with the truth. We truly do. Now, my church is notorious for saying I'm short-winded, so I'm going to try to do what Brother Gene says and act like there's no food down there. So, I know. But I really do think this is important, because I wasn't kidding earlier at all. Every message I have given this year, and because of my pastor, I've been able to speak many times over the year, many times over this past year. Every time I prepare one of these messages, and every time I get on my face and pray to ask God to help me, that word has rung out in my head like a bell. Remember. And as I was preparing for this sermon, I heard him say, wake up. Time to wake up. We've gotten lax in America. We have. And I'm thankful for it. I am, that I have lived in a country where I could worship and serve God without fear of anything.
Yes, sir.
But that's not the case anymore, folks. If you watch TV at all, you've seen politicians stand up on national television and say the greatest threat to this nation is Christian nationalists.
Yep.
Now, what is a Christian nationalist? It's a person that loves their country and loves their God. And we are the greatest threat this nation's got. Things are changing. Things are changing. And I think that's why this remembering is so important. Because when things get hard, how are you going to deal with it? How are you going to deal with it? You know, you look over in Africa, you look over in Africa, and you look over in Asia, and people are dying over there for their faith. Okay, we hear about it all the time. I listen to AFR. There's a program I listen to that talks about foreign missions. People are over there spilling their blood on the ground. They're walking the same path our Lord Christ walked.
Yeah.
All right, they're giving their lives for the gospel. We've had it easy, folks. Ain't none of us here been persecuted for our faith. Are you ready to be persecuted? Are you ready? Because it's coming.
Yeah.
It's coming in America. And we need to be ready. And I think that's why God is calling us to wake up. To wake up and be ready. To defend your faith and to be prepared for the trials and tribulations that are to come. And how do we deal with those trials and tribulations? We do exactly what Brother Glover was talking about a while ago. We remember. We look back and see what God has brought us through. You know, I've shared this with my Sunday school class, and I'll share it with y'all. You know, I shared a little bit earlier about my friend, you know, over there, that how we had a pretty sordid past before we both got right with God. But one of my bad characteristics as I walked this world was, I'm a pretty stubborn fellow. And when people in this world would look at me and go, hey, you know what, you need to do this, or this is going to happen right here, or else. Man, I take or else knowing it would get me in trouble. And my friend can tell you that. If you look me in the face and told me, do this or else, I'd be like, so what does or else consist of? Because that's where we're going. Just because I'm going to do it just to spite you. And I always thought that was a horrible attribute. I was like, Lord, I need to fix this in myself. Well, it's not. Because that attribute that I had used the wrong way is the very thing I'm going to use in the future.
Amen.
when they come to me and tell me to shut up, tell me that I can't talk about that homosexuality is wrong, all right? And you can't call yourself a gay Christian. That's no different than me looking at myself going, well, I'm a drunk alcohol Christian. I'm a drunk Christian. I'm an addict Christian. No, I'm not. I'm a Christian. A born-again child of God, and those things are not a part of my life no more.
Amen.
All right, so if you're saved, you can't be a gay saved person. All right, you can't say, I'm a gay Christian. No, you're a Christian who's evidently backslidden in homosexuality, and you get it right.
Amen.
You're not a Christian at all.
Amen.
Okay, one of the two. Just like a drunk's got to put down the bottle, and a drug addict's got to put away the pipe. You've got to change your life. But how do we do that? We remember the past. We remember what God has brought us through. And with that, I'm going to share a little bit of what God's brought me through. You know, Paul talks about in the Bible that he was the chief of sinners. I think I got real close to competing with him. I really do. I got into drugs for a long time. I'd lost a child when I was a young man. And not doing what Brother Glover was talking about earlier, about not worrying, I let it destroy me. I did. It ripped me apart. And by the time I met my friend, I was into drugs. I had turned away from God. Actually, I was at war with him. I was mad at him. I was. Didn't understand why he'd take my boy. I didn't. But here I am 35 years later, and I look back. No longer angry. I'm joyful. Because if nothing else, the one lesson that I learned from that experience in these 35 years of dealing with that is that I got 5 children living. Okay? If none of the rest of my children, I pray that they do, I do. But if none of the rest of my children ever get their lives right with God, I know I've got at least one son that I get to spend eternity with, serving and worshiping and praising God forever and ever and ever. When we take the time to remember what God does and remember what God is and who he is and what we are to him, we can find the courage to deal with these things that are coming. We can. Right, when we look back and think about what God brought us through, you know, I was a drunk. He sobered me up. Not only that, he cleaned me up. He cleaned up my mouth. I had one of the worst mouths you'd ever seen. I was raised. I was taught to cuss. Time I was 2 years old, my grandfather would set me on the counter of that beer store, and when people would come in the door, he'd say, what are they? And I don't know how to say this without saying it, but S-O-B, that's what my grandfather taught me to call people, S-O-B. Except I wasn't saying that. I had a horrible mouth. I don't cuss no more. And this thing, I didn't do it. Just one day I noticed it wasn't there no more. So when I look back and I see where I am today, do you know what that does for me?
Amen. Come on.
That gives me the courage to know
yes,
that whatever's in front of me,
that's right.
I ain't got to worry about it. Like that song. I shouldn't have to worry. He's going to bring me through to the other side. He has already. He's brought me through so much. He's brought all of us through so much. Not just me. I mean, I'm using myself as the example. But I believe that each and everybody here can find something in their life that God has brought them through. Something that you couldn't imagine any other way of going through it without him, because that's not, it would have turned out good if he hadn't been in it. That's what we find courage. You know, two of the main festivals that God established for the Jewish people, the Passover and the Festival of Booths, had a single purpose of reminding the Jewish people that one, he had freed them from Egypt, and he sustained them in the wilderness. We have to remember. We need to wake up. We need to remind our brothers and sisters to wake up. We need to tell everybody we can to wake up. The Lord's on his way.
Yeah.
You know, I had a friend of mine one time, you know, when you read the story of Stephen, the Bible says that when Jesus went to heaven, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. But when Stephen was being stoned, what did he see? He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father.
True.
I believe Jesus is standing today, folks. I don't believe he's sitting down right now. I think think he's looking at the Father going, is it time? Because there's not much more left. There's not. You read the Bibles, you read the prophecies, you read all the Word has to offer. And it tells us this time is getting close. His coming is soon. And it may not be in our lifetime, but it probably will be in the lifetime of our children, our grandchildren, or our great-grandchildren. It will. I believe it. I just don't see how it can tarry much longer. I just don't. Especially when you look at those in Sodom and Gomorrah. You know they're looking up at God going, hey, look, you destroyed us. How are you letting this stand? It can't be much longer, folks. We got to wake up. We got to wake up. We got to remember. We got to remember the Word. We got to remember why we go to church. You know, I gave a message at my church about why we go to church. We do it to encourage each other. Think about it. Without the church, we're out there on our own. And I'm going to tell you right now, I go a couple of weeks because of travel or work without going to church. I feel like a whoop dog by the time I get back. We got to remember. Remember who we are, what we're supposed to do. God has given us the instructions to get us through our lives and to get us to where we're going. We got to remember to read it. We got to remember to practice it. We got to remember to pray. You know, that song you sang, Miss Glory, about that direct line to the throne room. Amen. Man, that really touched me. I've never heard it before. And that was the most beautiful song I've heard in a long, long time. Because that is true. Here again, that's remembering who we are. We are the sons and daughters of God, and we don't have to go through a priest anymore to talk to our Father. We can get on our knees and talk to the great I Am. That's it, folks. That's it. Now, I had added more, or maybe if we had a bigger crowd. But since we don't, I'm just going to give it to y'all. You know, we've got a lot of wayward brothers and sisters out there around us who struggle, who don't go to church, who suffer with the trials of life because they don't know where to turn. You know, we need to start reaching out to people. You know, the Bible, Paul calls us the ambassadors of God. We're his ambassadors. We're his hands and feet. And what is our work supposed to be? I know the maintaining the church building is important. I know we need a place to gather. But this building is not the church. You are. You are. And you are. And you are. And I am. You know, we're the only thing that we can take with us to heaven. I've said that before. The only thing that we can take from this earth to glory is other people.
That's it.
Other people. And we're in a world right now that's hopeless. We're in a world right now that don't have no hope. They really don't. They're scared of everything. I mean, look at what they've done with COVID. Shutting down churches. And here's the sad thing about it. Churches do too. Now, we did it at ours to an extent because our, like y'all, our congregation is elderly. But there were some places that didn't have to, but they did. And there are some places that still ain't come back. They're still doing it. They're still having church on the internet. You know, we talked about that tonight. You know, that somebody heard about this, saw it online, and they're like, so are you broadcasting it live? You want to watch this, you've got to come. Right? You want to see, unless you want to see it next week. If you want to be here tonight and hear this, you've got to show up. And we need to show up. And we need to encourage others to show up. And I'm so glad that all y'all showed up. Because that shows that there's still a remnant. And that's the thing we got to remember. God's always going to have a remnant. Always. He's always going to have a people. He's always going to have a people. The question is, are we going to be a part of it? Because here's the thing, when these trials and tribulations come, people who are true, you know, those are not going to fall away. They are. You got people in these churches that tell you, troubles don't have to come your way, life can be great, you can have all the money you need to take care of anything you want. It's not what the Bible tells me.
Amen.
It's not. And it's not the life I've lived, it's not what I've seen with my experience. You know, the first message I ever gave at Jackson Chapel was 4 days before my father died. This past year, I had to speak on Father's Day. First Father's Day without my father. God tells me that I'm going to go through things. But if I remember, brought me through, and I'll have the courage to move forward with whatever's ahead of me. And we all need to remember that. We all need to encourage each other with that. We need to share that with anybody and everybody that will listen. Even if it hurts their feelings a little bit, I'd rather hurt their feelings and take the chance that they would get saved than to say, well, I don't want to hurt their feelings and watch them burn in hell. Because that's the simple fact of the matter, folks. We've got one or two destinations. There ain't none of this stuff that they want to teach, like, well, there is no hell and blah, blah, blah. The Bible's very clear. You're either going to spend eternity with God or you're going to burn. Period. Just that simple. Whether it's a burn of a fire or it's the burn of not being able to get access to Him. Whatever it is, the Bible says it's going to be bad. It's not going to be fun. Nobody's going to want to be there. And if we got friends and loved ones and family that are not saved, that's their destination. You know, I pray and I stay with my kids the whole time because God forbid when I get to the gates of heaven that I look and see my children going to hell. Because I know that when I get there, He'll wipe those tears from my eyes. But man, what a loss that would be to me. To any of us. To any of us. I'm going to turn this back over to you, Gene. As you leave here tonight, remember. Remember to tell your family. Remember to tell your friends. Remember your past so that you can share with them the things that God has done for you so that He knows and they can know there's nothing they're going through, no places they've been. There's enough grace at the throne of God for the backslider and the lost and anybody else. There truly, truly is. We need to tell them and we need to remember. Thank y'all, and I love y'all.